Okay, good evening, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to session 15. It seems like it's been a while since we've done one of these. Having that half-term holiday was good last week, and I'm a bit of a rest from it. But I was having a bit of writer's block. Where do I go with session 15 after 10 days off? It was kind of, I was in a rhythm. And then it struck me today, literally. I was doing the red route at Sherwood Pines, and I came off my bike. I got, if you can see, a bit of a bruise coming. I'm not gonna labour my battle scars too much, but yeah, I was very lucky actually, it could have been a lot worse, but I hit a root, come off my bike, and I've been trying this thing recently of, instead of swearing, because I am prone to that outside of school, very professional in the classroom, but I do have a bit of a loose tongue when it comes to the Anglo-Saxon sometimes at home. I've been trying to shout out, when I'm angry, the names of literary characters, and today it was Dudley Dursley's turn. Nice bit of plosive alliteration. I think it's a good name to shout when you're angry and you don't want to F and Jeff it. So Dudley Dursley, and I thought, as I got back up from the dirt and got back on the bike, I thought, I've got an idea for this. We're going to talk about modern day literary villains, so to speak. You know, the bad guys of the books. How do modern writers tackle this? We've kind of looked at maybe how Victorian novelists did that, looked at heroes and villains in a conventional sense, but today we're looking at slightly more modern writers, and J.K. Rowling is the one that came up. So, when we first meet Dudley in the first book of Harry Potter, it's his birthday, and Harry, very dutifully, is frying eggs. He's been told, you know, get on top of the breakfast, Harry, you're looking after that, you know, just kind of fallen into this domestic role that we sort of see Harry as a skivvy and a slave at this point, living under the stairs. He's definitely a second-class citizen at his uncle and aunt's house. Meanwhile, Dudley Dursley, as I'm sure you know, and throughout the whole of the Harry Potter series, he's not a redeemable character either. He just kind of stays as this menace in Harry's life, although he becomes increasingly irrelevant as the novels progress, of course. Dudley Dursley, why do we hate him? What is it about this kind of character? How does J.K. Rowling evoke this kind of anger and hatred towards him so early on? So again, like we did in session 8, for example, maybe 7, we looked at DAD, how to analyse a character we first meet using description, action, dialogue. It's kind of the same thing, you'd be doing the same thing. What you tend to find with modern writers is sometimes it's a little bit more subtle, this front-loading, but it's still certainly there if you read between the lines. So, this is what we've got. Quick read from page 21 of The Philosopher's Stone. So it's chapter 2, The Vanishing Glass, Dudley's birthday. Harry was frying eggs by the time Dudley arrived in the kitchen with his mother. Dudley looked a lot like Uncle Vernon. He had a large pink face, not much neck, small watery blue eyes, and thick blonde hair that lay smoothly on his thick, fat head. Aunt Petunia often said that Dudley looked like a baby angel. Harry often said that Dudley looked like a pig in a wig. Harry put the plates of egg and bacon on the table, which was difficult as there wasn't much room. Dudley, meanwhile, was counting his presents. His face fell. 36! He said, looking up at his mother and father. That's 2 less than last year. Darling, you haven't counted Aunt Marge's present, see? It's here under the big one from Mummy and Daddy. All right, 37 then, said Dudley, going red in the face. Harry, who could see a huge Dudley tantrum coming on, began wolfing down his bacon as fast as possible, in case Dudley turned the table over. Aunt Petunia obviously scented danger too, because she said quickly, "Oh, and we'll buy you another 2 presents while we're out today. How's that, Popkin? 2 more presents, is that all right?" Dudley thought for a moment. It looked hard work. Finally, he said, slowly, "So I'll have the 39 sweetums," said Aunt Petunia. "Oh." Dudley sat down heavily and grabbed the nearest parcel. "All right, then." Uncle Vernon chuckled. "A little tight wants his money's worth, just like his father. Attaboy, Dudley." It ruffled Dudley's hair. At that moment, the telephone rang and Aunt Petunia went to answer it, while Harry and Uncle Vernon watched Dudley unwrap the racing bike, the cine camera, the remote control aeroplane, 16 new computer games and a video recorder. He was ripping the paper off a gold wristwatch when Aunt Petunia came back from the telephone looking both angry and worried.
"Bad news, Vernon," she said. "Mrs. Figgs broke her leg. She can't take him."
She jerked her head towards Harry's direction.
Dudley's mouth fell open in horror, but Harry's heart gave a leap. Every year on Dudley's birthday, his parents took him and a friend out for the day to adventure parks, hamburger bars and the cinema. Every year, Harry was left behind with Mrs. Fig, a mad old lady who lived two streets away. Harry hated it there. The whole house smelled of cabbage, and Mrs. Fig made him look at photographs of old cats she once owned. Okay, so that's kind of enough. We've had this opening, you know, this first encounter with Dudley, and we've heard him speak. His first words in the entire novel are him counting his birthday presents, 36. So, in terms of dialogue, he's just coming across as a petulant, obviously, young man. We don't know how old he is. We're guessing he's Harry's age, so he's a young boy going into probably his teenage years at this point. But he's not happy. He's only got 36 presents, which, again, you know, we're thinking spoiled brat instantly with that, aren't we? But you've also got this kind of physical description. So he's like his dad. And we've met enough of his dad already in the book. This is chapter 2, remember. We've already met Vernon enough to know that we're not particularly keen on him either. So it looks like his dad. We can infer going to act like his dad. The description, the physical description, is not particularly flattering either. You know, small, not much neck, small watery blue eyes, blonde hair that lay on his thick fat head. This is not a flattering description by any means. His mum thinks he smells of roses, but Harry often calls him a pig in a wig, which I think as a reader we are siding with Harry and have a chuckle at that, aren't we? There's also this idea of slowness of intellect. You know, he can't count to 39. His mum has to help him. He's also he's kind of infantilized by his mum as well. She calls him, you know, Sweetums and like Diddykins and things like that. So these kind of pet names that are clearly more suited to a 4-year-old than a 13, 14-year-old. So this kind of treating him like an infant, again, it makes him less likable from the off. Beyond that, you've got his name, Dudley Dursley, this kind of plosive alliteration. You know, characters in literature in general that have alliterative names are either usually idiots, and we are encouraged to laugh at them. You know, it's a kind of foolish kind of coxcomb clown-like thing to do, to have someone have a name that's alliterative. There aren't that many, funnily enough. I was thinking about this. You know, there aren't that many writers that give their characters alliterative names, probably for that reason. J.K. Rowling, however, does, so we can't just go on that. You know, Luna Lovegood, Severus Snape, you know, there are other characters within the Harry Potter franchise that have also got alliterative names, so we can't say that's the reason we hate him, because that wouldn't fit. Luna Lovegood certainly wouldn't fit Severus Snape in the long run either, although of course he's the ultimate misdirection, isn't he? So what we'll do, we'll think about what else is it in this kind of character, not just from what I've read, but beyond that. And I think there's a series of things with Dudley. I'll put that down for a second. Of course, we don't like his dad, and he's an extension of his dad. His name, again, I really apologise if you're from Dudley, but you know, Dudley in the West Midlands is an industrial town, so it's kind of like, you know, the kind of the black country, and you know, again, that kind of stereotype of him. And his dad, of course, being an industrialist, I think he works for, is it Grummings, sells drills, you know, this is a kind of clearly an industrialist. The family, they live on Privet Drive, you know, Privet is obviously a short hedge, usually you find in suburbia, you know, these kind of modern new estates that spring up on the outskirts of cities. And suburbia is filled by these kind of aspirational middle classes, people like the Dursleys. And I think J.K. Rowling's pointing the finger of fun at these people, saying, you know, this kind of suburban mentality, the kind of private. I mean, again, the word Privet Drive, you think private, or but also nosy neighbour. You can just peer over the Privet, and of course Petunia fits that bill marvellously. He goes to a school. He's preparing to go to a school called Smeltings. Which is the buying the uniform for, aren't they? So yeah, I mean, from that we could infer he's 11, 12 years of age. He's about to start his big school. Smeltings, again, the word smelting is like an iron forge, so an industrial link to that as well. I think all of this points to this idea that the Dursleys, per se, the family, are new money. They're affluent, they've got money, but it's new money. And they represent the kind of the worst of the modern middle classes. I think that's what J.K. Rowling is trying to satire and point her finger of fun at, you know, take the mickey out of satirically. Okay, so yeah, Dudley Dursley is a douchebag. That's the upshot of this, you know. Nice bit of a clickbait style title for my session today. I thought I'd hook a few more of you in. You'd be really glad to hear there's no homework for this one. I just simply wanted you to have a listen to my breakdown of how this kind of works, how writers are thinking when they're introducing characters. So remember, DAD is still important. Description, action, dialogue. The holy trinity of how we introduce a character. What we analyse when we're looking at a first encounter with a new character. But again, with a lot of this, you also have to read between the lines. You also have to look at other things like their names, their connotations, or their other kind of family connections, and what the overall picture is pointing towards. So hopefully you've enjoyed that. If you do want to do an extension, you want to send me some work that's a response to this, you could write a short description of how you think Dudley Dursley is first introduced in the novel, if you've got a copy of this at home. Doubt you'll find it online, because of course it's a modern novel and it's still kind of copyrighted in that sense. That's the great thing about Victorian literature. You can go online, PDF, find it, print it off if you wish, read it online. You don't tend to get that with stuff that's been written in the last 30, 40 years, because the people who wrote these things are still alive. They still want to make money out of it, understandably. So yeah, if you've got a copy of that, by all means. If not, grab a book that you've read recently. If you've got a different modern children's book on the shelf, pick it up, think about a character. It doesn't have to be one I've read. I can read your analysis and that's enough. Tell and write me about the way that they've been introduced. You know, what does the writer do? Is it the way they describe, the way they act, the way they speak? Is it their name? Is it kind of the subtle things that are going on in between all that? Okay, so that was session 15. Hope it's not been too long, not been counting. I am going to be doing a few more GCSE style ones in the next few sessions. So the next couple will be kind of more year 10, well, 9, 10, 11. So bear with me if you're a 7, 8 watching this. But I do need to start drilling down with some of this GCSE work as well. Lovely, over and out.